So if you remember, last time I stated that the space of morphisms from things that are away from each other by alpha is the space of two forms by itself. I should have called it, but never mind, let's start. Such that alpha equals beta. For those of you who weren't here or forgot, these pieces of data, such as alpha and beta, have a transparent meaning. So, just a quick reminder, alpha measures the only non-trivial, really non-trivial thing there, and that is to say the zeroth operation between vector fields is defined up to things that aren't really under our control, and the room for maneuver is exactly a possibility to add a one form. And we prove that a one form added to a zero product of study data is automatically the value of a three form on two out of the three arguments evaluated on side and data. Likewise here, morphisms. There is very little that's under our control. A vector field goes to itself up to a one form, and beta is exactly that. So it's a two form, such that if you plug psi into it, you get a one form, and that's the only thing that can be used to define a map from which this condition arises. So after this reminder, let me show you that if you forget about everything vertex, everything of content here, then any such thing immediately gives you a characteristic class.
So each, sure, defines its characteristic class. That is an element of the following, as they say, hyperhomology group H2 with coefficients in X and values in the truncated drum complex. So we start with just list all the groups that have been imported. This is as follows, and I will show you that. Oh, not only I will show how this class is constructed, but along the way I will remind you what, rather tell you what I mean under this group. The only thing I would like to mention right away is that the cohomology uses both things, the kind of Czech degree cohomology in the direction of x, if you will, and the Durand degree in the direction of this the round complex, except that the round degree is shifted because in this signal degree 0 and this in degree 1. Otherwise, you would have H4 or something like that. This is as follows. You imagine again X. And now X is covered by a bunch of such
things. X and M is the same thing.
M. From now on, M equals X. I will sometimes make this. I should have started with X. So we have a covering. So a good cover, meaning that each UI is good in the sense I explained. And then over each UI, I have an object, Li. Now let's focus on the intersection. So over the intersection, I have two such. Or rather, I take one and another, restricting each to the intersection. They don't have to be the same. So I start with that cell and choose, so that's a choice. There's no reason to believe that there are restrictions to the intersection are the same. So we can subtract, and that defines me a bunch of forms, one form on each intersection. That gives me a Czech one co-chain. So the degree in the direction of Czech is the number of indices minus one. Zero chain to chain will have only one. And you will see. What can I do then? I can go over to triple intersection. And over each side, I will have the Czech differential of that co-chain. Which you compute by the standard formula. You will have alpha, so I think of three indices, you know, like they do in the simplicial world. And I will throw away one, get a form, I will have to restrict it to the triple intersection. And then I will have three of them, each for each index, nested.
XL minus alpha IK plus IK T cell. Finally, I missed I given K plus alpha IK. All right, let me immediately start drawing a picture. So this hyperhomology, this word refers to there being a bicomplex. It's similar algebraically, although not as far as the content goes, to bi-graded complex maybe be considered last time. So I will have two directions, the Durand direction and the Chilk direction. So my three forms in the Durand direction have degree one. I started with alpha ij, that thing lived here. And then I did the checklist. I put that thing. These three index expressions. The next step in the construction of the class is the observation that on triple intersections, on each such triple intersection, there is a two-fold. Let me write it like this to indicate a triple intersection. Such that d beta r j k is exactly the value of the check that I computed that. This is the reason why. It's because, what does this thing say? I should have fixed everything on one board. Now I'm paying the price of moving it back and forth again and again. Look what happens here. Each such summon tells you how you go from I to J, and then from J to K, and then finally back to I. So all this happens in the triple intersection, describes as the objects change from I to J and from J to K, and finally back to I. There is no reason to believe that the object we obtained in the end is the same as this, but it is isomorphic, because at each step there was an isomorphism. That's how alpha ij were chosen. Here it is. They're different. But one is isomorphic to this plus this. So if you go from Li back, where did I start doing this? So when you go from Li back to Li, you will obtain an object that is automatically isomorphic to the initial one. And therefore, there must be a form like that because of our description of the morphisms. So that's my two-check co-chain of the round degree zero. And finally, this is something that we'll evolve, you may want to think about. These can be chosen in such a way that the check differential is zero. It's because each is a certain conjugation, if you write of map, so each such four encodes a map, and if you write all those maps, you start to get a translation. You may want to think about it. And finally, this, the RAM map, is zero by definition, because all these are closed. Now you see what I meant by that hypercohomology complex. It's a bicomplex. In one direction you have just, you know, zero and one given by two forms and three forms. You have in the other direction check co-chains obtained using a good cover, and two differentials belong in one direction, check in another. So having a degree two cohomology means, so the overall degree, as you see, is 1 plus 1, 2. Here it's 0 plus 2, 2. And having a, what is it, co-cycle. The co-cycle condition means that the sum of the differentials is 0. And that's a pictorial description. Agreed? Well, of course, the construction of this element is hugely non-unique. I started with a bunch of LIs, and that choice was arbitrary. Of course, I can start with any other bunch, and any other bunch is obtained by, since all my sets are small, by taking arbitrarily closed three forms on each member of a cover. So of course I could, so to get all these, starting with having one choice, to get all other choices means taking an arbitrary one co-chain like this and applying the check differential. That clearly replaces alpha ij with alpha ij by definition of the check map. It's alpha I minus alpha j or up to the side. You may then want to, so we have two things at the intersection. Remember I told you the difference that's part of the definition of the job. The difference is defined, but not uniquely. It's because an object is not determined by a closed form. Determined by closed precise morphism class. Determined by closed form after an addition of a co-boundary. Therefore, another space for maneuver is provided by a choice of two forms on each intersection. So a check, what? One co-cycle, the value is made of two, to which you can apply these around. This, of course, has an effect of changing the transitivity condition. So the result being that what is actually associated with yours is not so much the phrase. So I'll explain this phrase. If you return this last, it's characteristic. Characteristic class, which is an element of not so much as H2, but rather Z2M with coefficients in this complex. Modulo the total differential of V1 of section. Here is a picture. If one studies the general theory of joints, which of course I have neither time nor expertise to talk about, one proves that up to isomorphism, a joint is determined by its characteristics. What's important to us, and that really is crucial, that's why I spend time doing this, what's important for us is, so, the characteristic class equals zero if and only if the joint has a global section. So has a global section. That is to say, back to our concrete situation, that is to say there is a globally defined vortex algebraic defined on M a vortex algebraic. Let me explain this. Well, in one direction this is kind of absolutely tautological. If there is a globally defined joint, then, so if there is an on M, then you can start playing this game. You can simply choose alpha I to be L, restricted to your, and alpha IJ will all be zero as well as the rest. There's nothing to measure the difference. Everything can be chosen to be equal to zero. So in one direction, as I said, it's tautological. In the opposite direction, it is also something that's easier to understand from one's goal, and I'll just say a few words. So why is it? Why is it that if the characteristic class is zero, then there is a globally defined object? Well, in one sentence, the cohomology being equal to zero simply means that the given object can be glued so that transitivity holds. Look how it works. So we started with some Li, and we get alpha ij and beta ijk so that they conspire to give a co-shape. Now suppose that co-cycle. Suppose this co-cycle is a co-boundary. What does it mean? So we then have this and this. So that the image under the total is here. By the way, let's close. So this projection of the differential is of course zero. So this class being the image of that means what? For example, focus on this vertex. Alpha ij is changed to, should be a formula written here. Here it is. And I raise it. But it doesn't matter. So you pick alpha I and then each alpha ij is changed. Now, being a co-boundary means that the new co-chain living there is the image of this one. It means that beta ij are the gluing functions. And then if you think about it, you would realize that the fact that the check differential of this gives you what you had previously for transitivity. It will simply mean that the transitivity of the new shift, that the gluon functions are transitive. Another such general nonsense result is the meaning of the lower cohomology groups. This is another thing that will be important. So, if suppose the characteristic class is zero, well then, there are global objects. Set of globally defined shifts is not empty. What is the set of isomorphic classes? So lemma, I don't want you to call it lemma, it's another bit of absolute nonsense. If so, the set of isomorphic classes is a is a so the characteristic class lies in H2. Now I have to pick the previous one, H1. H1 of F. 2 of F. Stay close. So the set of isomorphic classes is more or less identified with this group. Or more precisely, it is a torsor over. The reason for that is, of course, a result of a similar diagram chase using this same picture. So, in order to explain this, I'll make another copy and to move what I don't need. So, suppose we have an object. What other objects are there? Well, locally, you get all of them by adding appropriate alphas. What an addition of alpha I, so I'm replacing Li with Li plus alpha I. What's the effect of this replacement is if you look at the intersection? Well, of course, bunch of alpha ij equal to alpha I minus alpha j. So over each intersection, you'll get a difference. Can I still do? You see, what I'm doing is I've taken a globally defined object. It consists of pieces. I pull it apart. I'm trying to be a movie star, you see. So I'm pulling them apart. What's the price to be paid? At the intersection, these discrepancies arise. I can only glue them back if each difference is what? The differential of a 2-form. Therefore, there must be a bunch of 2-forms on the intersection so that the theorem of them gives, corrects this newly occurring mistake. So that really is now a gluing function. So you have to go from I to J, from then JK, and then back to I, and the transitivity should hold. The transitivity here means exactly that the check differential of R is co-chain zero. That, of course, is the Z1 co-cycle condition. Various such objects are still isomorphic if, and I will do it for you, if you can pick zero co-cycle consisting of two forms so that these two are killed by respective application of the derived or the check differential. Agreed? All right, so What's the usable of it?
Somewhat surprising that a certain concrete application can be seen immediately. Remember, we started these discussions with the example of CP1. Now, from this point of view, question, is there a CDO or CP1 obtains an answer immediately? For we have no idea, perhaps, how to compute the characteristic classes of such jurors. But in this case, there isn't much to compute. What do you think this cohomological group equals? It's a very simple question. Hint. It's as simple as it gets. Oh, come. Int, dimension. Of course, Alberta Tamayuki may disregard the silliness. What's the dimension of CP1? 1. This 2, 3, there is nothing. So there is simply nothing there. So this is 0. And therefore, not only this is 0, but by the way, the first homology group is also 0. And so there is a unique set. There is a unique such CDR. And of course, that was the one we constructed. I would like to show you that in this, I would like to point out that in this particular case, this abstract nonsense all of a sudden becomes surprisingly perhaps effective. For remember, the direct computation looked like some small miracle. Remember, we had this field, which we computed the first operation to be non-zero, which almost killed the entire project at the outset. We needed it to be zero, but then, if you use the partial without anything for the canonical vertex of the derivation, then I can write that this partial has nothing to do with this one. So it looked like a miracle that an addition of these corrections saved the situation. So much so that we didn't quite believe that it all makes sense at that point. Our discussion. But from the general point of view, as you see, all of this works simply that there is, for the simple reason that there is no room for things to go wrong. So one way or another, it's bound to work. Here it is. I will now move on to have the main result I wanted to report on. But before I do that, let me suggest an exercise for people who would like to think this over. So step out the case of twisted differential operator, something that I started with. Using this language, you should get the group H2. With these coefficients, very similar, but
all the degrees go down by one. And the characteristic class height, TPO, like there, and B. Isomorphisms are like this. That's the set of isomorphism classes. But I think the characteristic class is in this case. Characteristic class is an abstraction to there being a global section, object section, say a global TDO. Who can point out a globally defined TDO that exists for any L? Differential operators, of course. So there is always D sub M, and therefore class cannot but vanish. So you will get isomorphist classes like this. Another question that I would like you to think about. So there is this thing, but there is also, whenever there is a blank bundle L, ring of differential operators on L is defined. It's a specific example of such things. So defined for each vector bundle L. So how are objects like this? How such things fit to the general framework indicated by the first set. Right, here is then the main result. So that I used already chi. I have to stick to it. So that chi of vertex of this adjoint, so chi of this adjoint, be the characteristic class. So there is a whole series of characteristic classes of vector bundles. In particular, there is the, I think, the technical meaning of it. I'll skip over the geometry. I'll just mention the terminology and then try to offer you a way to a concrete result as concretely as possible. So let me just remind you that for any vector bundle, in particular for the tangent vector, defined for any such bundle is the a second component of the Chern character. It is up to an overall sign, perhaps even an overall constant. Since we work over C, doesn't really matter. You have, for one thing, you have Chern classes of any vector bundle, such as this. And then there is a Chern character. And the second component is, again, up to an overall coefficient, is C2 minus half of C1 squared. So the main result is about, is that characteristic class we are interested in is that, more or less. In fact, the proof of which I will only be able to give you some glimpses exhibits an explicit formula, a fit classical one, for a representative of this cohomology class. So remember, what I have to do is an explicit formula. So first of all, I'll introduce some notation. So we are back to this situation when we have a manifold and a cover, and we have coordinates, x, dx, x prime, ddx prime on each of them. And whenever I have this on the intersection, I have phi super ij. Did you call their matrix? So here is the definition of exactly the matrix that gives you the transformation that is doing or structure functions of the corresponding rotating bundle. So the definition is, if you differentiate along the alpha's coordinate on one and the beta's coordinate on another, the result is, well, some number depending on alpha and beta. So you have a bunch of these numbers, and that gives me that matrix. So in other words, here I change the matrix with those entries. So ij will, for my discussion, be fixed, and alpha and beta are labels attached to coordinates. One percent.
Excuse me, what is x?
X and x prime are coordinates on one and another.
Coordinates?
Yes, coordinate systems. X and x prime. So x, x prime. Or the other way around. I hope it doesn't really matter. Now, likewise, d alpha means d dx, with the corresponding index of d alpha prime will be the other way around. All right, so what is it that I have to give you if I am to define a certain class in that complex? Well, look at the picture. On the intersection, on the double intersections, I have to give you a closed 3-4, and on triple intersections, a 2-4. There goes. On UI, the closed 3-4 is 1-6. Let me write a formula and then comment on it. So there will be a bunch of matrices. There will be several of them, so let me immediately tell how to understand them. That's a matrix. I and J are fixed once and for all. Perhaps it's a good idea to just erase it. So it's just a pair of indices that we are looking at. A pair of open sets, rather. So this is a matrix. So this is also a matrix. You just take this and by a matrix and differentiate each component. So you have a one-form filled out n by a matrix. Even though these are forms, not these are, so you can multiply them, this matrix and this matrix, using the usual undergraduate linear algebra rules. You will get another matrix, also with values in one force. Now I will write down two more copies like this. and multiply them using the wedge product. It's the usual matrix multiplication, except that one forms are multiplied using wedges, not so much the usual product. But otherwise, the formula is, so if I have one such matrix and another, then the product is a matrix with entries A alpha r, wedge, beta, D R gamma summation of the factors. That's what this means. You have to do it three times. So in each double intersection that defines a three form. It's a very classic expression. It is not our discovery. So our discovery is that you can get this expression by doing some vertex algebra, and that's what this short course is all about. One. The triple intersections. We need two forms. Here is a similar but even more complicated formula. Oh yeah, yeah. What's mean? Is there some? Tell me. What's wrong with the formula as I wrote it? May I elicit it with some response from you. So what's wrong with this formula as I wrote it? Does it make sense? What is it that we want? I told you. Even if you have slept all this time, you should have heard one of the last two, three sentences. And they were that on the double intersection, we must get a three form. Is this a three form? No, it's a matrix three form. How do we get a three form from a matrix? We do the trace. That's the classic formula I wanted to mention. I remembered about the trace because this second formula also involves it. So in this case, it's even somewhat less pretty, but still very classic. So Y, R, J matrices tend to be in the word one. I, J, K. There is no summation here. It's just I, J, and K are fixed. And then D, phi, J, K, which D, phi, I, J, trace. It's a similar expression. Now we have four matrices. First, codense. Jacobians, and then matrix one forms, and then we multiply them according to those rules and get an n by n matrix 2-4, and then do the trace. It's a classic result that such cycle represents the characteristic class written above. Our modest contribution is that we derive these formulas by doing vertex algebra minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3 problems. Any questions? I have a few minutes to go, so I'll say a few words how this, how such formulas are arrived at. I don't have the slightest chance of showing you the whole computation. Complete even to some extent, but I will at least show you where the computation starts. So that you will see that the main thing here is of course not imagination, but rather hard work and then a bit of optimism that in the end you're going to get something that makes sense. So what kind of a computation one is supposed to do here? Well, just go over the definition. I have ui and uj, and leaving on each of them is, since I have a billion bases, v1 prime, which I choose on each of the two sets, living on each, I have this standard algebra of parallel differential operators generated by those fields. What Victor called even fermions, and what we sometimes call beta gamma systems. So we have these, and then we have coordinates, and the OPs of these fields are those that I mentioned more than once. Now, of course, each of them makes sense on the intersection. And we would like to identify them, which may or may not be possible, but at least one can try. That's how the characteristic classes. So I want to identify over intersection UI with some expression in DJ prime. How can I do it? The main part of the formula is forced upon me by the definition of the vertex algebra. There we have vector fields up to one floor, and vector fields transform as they're supposed to. So we identify the I by some of the formulas I wrote with, I need my Jacobian, something like this. So a student of differential geometry would write a formula like this, and we, working with all the algebras, will insert minus one. It's clear what I mean. I mean this field, perhaps for one cell is correct. Minus one times that. So this is valid for I varying from one to the dimension of that. Will this work? Well, we have to verify, at least if there is, yes, and of course, xi goes, you know, to, I will not be using these. There are blue usual coordinate transformations that define the manifold itself. And those are also forced upon us, and with functions, there is no room for maneuver at all. It is these Fs that give the Jacobian by doing the partial derivative. All right. Now we have to make sure that these fields satisfy the same products as the initial ones. And the crucial, as we already know from experience, is of course given by the product number one. So what I have to do is write one such thing, Fis minus one here. F, G, X. S is not F, B, T, this time.
So is this summation over S?
Yes, yes, I'm sometimes using the, of course, sometimes using the Einstein convention for instance. Otherwise,
and what is the definition of the minus one product?
That's part of the definition of this vertex algebra structure. I know, this is a dishonest answer, but that's the best I can give. It equals. As an element of my vector space, it's the same. So, it's the same as the, if you will, as in a usual situation. But the operations are involved. Anyway, it's part of that. All right. So, how do we compute such thing? Well, we have the Borchers identity. So, for example, we can start computing the first operation with this is the operation minus one, and we can compute this thing, and the result will be that it is not zero. the result will be, I believe, if I'm not terribly mistaken, will be minus dt phi fis. That's a function. That's the usual. This now is the usual geometric computation. Vector field applied to the function. So it's a function times, not a similar function. Ds prime fg phi dt. All of this can be rewritten in a matrix form. So details of this computation I leave out. But it follows easily from our convention. Remember, the first operation between one forms and vector fields is given by, so some of the operations are purely classical. First operation between vector fields and one form is simply the evaluation of the one form on the vector field. So whenever you have two vectors that misbehave as far as the first operation goes, you correct it. There is a way to correct it. So you say that di goes not exactly where we prescribed that it go naively, but you add half or subtract. Let's subtract half of the value of a kind of metric, metric evaluated on the vector field, which will give you a one form. The actual formula is as follows. Half of trace of phi inverse, so just an inversion of this matrix, and then this matrix differentiated with respect to the R. That's one matrix times another phi inverse d phi. There is nothing complicated there. You see, this expression is, you think of this as a metric whose values on ds, or rather di and dg, is given by these expressions. So you cook up the two forms such that di dg, this two form, call it g, evaluated on di dg, sends it to this expression. Then this thing simply is, as I said, minus 1 half g evaluated on di. It's a very simple-minded computation. It's valid in any vertex algebra of the type I described. If you add one form, then the effect on the multiplication number one is very easy. You just plug in to this one form the corresponding vectors. And of course, the definition simply means that this term will go away. One of them will give you one half, another will give you another half. They will cancel. That's a bad term. But if it's a minus, I'm not 100% certain. It's either plus or minus. I'm not 100% certain of any of the indices, but that's very close to the correct answer. And I told you how it is obtained. You think of this as the value of a metric on the basis vector, and then you correct the result by this. So what does the general theory tell me? It tells me that once on, I'm back to the reminding you what it means that for any two objects, a difference is defined to be a closed three-fold. It's exactly this. If you normalize your structure by imposing that the first product of vector fields is zero, then the only room for maneuver is the zero product is given by L. So now that you have these mu, so I wanted to say that f sends the I to that expression. And that definition was wrong. the correct definition is as I described it. So F actually sends EI to this plus that correction. So this is the correction. Once those have been constructed, then automatically, thanks to our classification, the zeros operation is doesn't have to be zero. In that algebra, it was zero, but here it will be some alpha evaluated on d phi, dj. And that's the alpha you will get if you carefully compute everything. So, that's my alpha. I have a, for the record, I have a handwritten notes where this formula is derived. This particular formula is not that hard. It's doable to anybody here who feels like spending like half an hour computing. It's not half an hour because you stop making mistakes. But in the end of the day, this formula is not that hard. And that's the computation. So you have one such expression, another obtained by replacing I with j. And then you do the zero operation using the vertex algebra exponents. And you will get a one form in the sense that there will be an expression involving x is sub minus 1 and x 1x sub minus 2. That's the hallmark of there being a form. X minus 1 is the function and x minus 2 is ddx. That's another rule of the game that I explained last time. So that's what you will get. So once the alphas have been found, then you do this triple thing. You go from I, j using that formula, from j, k using a similar formula with I and j replaced with j and k, and then back from k to I. That's a much more strenuous effort than that computation. And if everything goes smoothly, you will get an automorphism of d sub ui that sends di to itself plus that expression. You can say that this is a more complicated computation, but that's how the main theorem is. So after a short break, I'll tell you a few words about one of nicer such examples. The case of the manifold equal to the simple complex. First of all, what will the general classification tell us in this case? This is zero simply because G acts on itself freely. So that's because the vector bundle over G is trivial. How about the isomorphic classes? That's this homology group Let me confuse it very briefly. At least I'll show you the steps, and people interested in geometry will reconstruct the missing detail. So the point here is G is, of course, an affine manifold, such as the SLF, you know, given by the polynomial equation. So one likes working with sheaves of all modules. Now, this is not the space of Gauss form. You can multiply form by a function. Nevertheless, you can observe that the complex in question, there's a morphism of complexes from this to the nicer, bigger part of the Dirac complex. So there is a map there. It's a map of complexes, therefore there is a map of cohomology. Let me call this complex simply G greater than or equal to 2. The point is that this natural map is a nice one. But this is something that people interested in applied geometry may want to think about. But once this is done, then it's easy to proceed. This group is easy to compute. It's a standard machinery. If you have a hypercohomology like this, you can first do, you know, Czech, and then the RAM, and then whatever else there is. So to technically use a standard spectral sequence and stuff like that. And since G is affine, it's easy to see that the result is simply the first usual Dirac cohomology. That is to say, you replace this shift with the space of global forms. So this is just the usual Dirac, except that remember,
X is the same as G.
Sure.
So all the letters are the same.
No matter what, yeah, in a sense. Right. Except that now my previous conventions run into a dramatic collision with what you should think about it. So, remember I told you the RAM was shifted. So this is degree one, but it is shifted. My shift was one that placed two into zero and three into one, etc. The first cohomology, therefore, are those that live here. So this is really the same as the usual unshifted Dirac on G. It's a classic result that this space is one-dimensional. And in fact, it's one-dimensional because of a specific and also classical reason. You see, there is a Dirac complex on G, but along with group G, there is also the corresponding simple real G. It has its own Chevalier cohomology complex. And there is a morphism of complexes that send I exterior forms to omega I by extending a form that lives at the unit to the whole thing using the right translation. So So this lies inside there by means of right invariant force. So the point I'm making is that this matter, there is a classic map, morphism of complexes, and it is a quasi-isomorphism. This map is a quasi-isomorphism. So, in addition to this claim that the group of interest is one-dimensional, there is now a claim that this is identified with a third homology of G with trivial coefficients, and the class by the following by the class of the following three forms. I will call it omega. That sends x, y, z to x evaluated on the bracket of y and z. I'm sorry, I've done too much, but at least I will finish this introduction here. So where, as you may have guessed, this means the unique optical proportionality invariant in a product. So again, to repeat, so the classification of CDOs is given by the group. It can be identified with the third Durham homology on G, and this canonical quasi-isomorphism gives, via the Lie algebra homology, a representative. So this is a three form on the Lie algebra. It defines a three form on the group by extending it in a right invariant manner. Let me call this form omega, if I have a chance. So the point of all this somewhat chaotic discussion is that the classification tells us that there is a one-parameter family of isomorphism classes of CDOs over G. All right. Can we make this more explicit? Yes, we can, and this probably could have been made at the very beginning of my discussions. I started with the case of CP-ROM by doing things by hand, but the case of G could also have been done from the outset. And I'm turning it and explicit. Construction of what? So again, I have my G, I have its algebra, that will fix an invariant inner product. The space of all such is my C.
So simple.
Yeah, it's a simple Lie algebra, a simple Lie algebra. It can be done in greater generality, but it is not particularly instructive. Let's fix this basic case. So, given this, I would like to give you a construction of a family of CDOs. And that is how I will construction of a assembly of the for each in a product, a vertex algebra, or a sheaf over G. But since G is a finite, there isn't much difference between a such sheaf or a space of global sections. So depending on circumstances, I will think of this. For the time being, I will mostly work in with something that's globally defined. And sheaf defined, as I explained, is very easy. You can, if you have the vertex algebra of this type, allowing it to divide by some function is not a problem, as I explained. So it is not a big deal. Anyway, how this can be constructed? Very easily. So first of all, of course, given this, we can construct the famous universal defined vertex algebra. I will even, so there are several ways, so what I want to say is, in a sense, that perhaps can, since I'm lacking time, but in a sense, it should be more or less obvious that you can take this vertex algebra and tensor it over C with, I wanted to say functions over G. But of course, I need the vertex algebra derivation, so I will need the functions of the jet space. So my claim is that this thing carries an obvious vertex algebra structure. Give the statement a thought and tell me, does it appear, if not obvious, but at least very plausible? Well, it's giving this thing a vertex algebra structure is the mechanism that underlies everything I told you. So if I have two V-algebra elements, then I know this. If I have an algebra element and a function, then, of course, I'll put it this way, since clearly the space of functions is a G module, so that because G operates on G, and depending on how you think of it, if this G operates on this, then it means that there is a map from G to vector fields on G. And therefore we can define, so let's explain that this is a G module, and then we can define for X in G, F in the space of function. The nth bracket to be exactly what you think it to be, x evaluated on f of g on f, thanks to this map, if n is 0, and 0 if n is greater than 0. And that, no matter, so I don't know, and then extend.
So is this G module century then a joint action?
This is not a joint action.
No.
Well, you know, this is not an adjoint action. This is a left action by left translations. G doesn't act on the group by a joint action would be G on the right, G inverse on the left. No, just the right, left or right translations. Same left translation, and this is a a mapping to right hand variant. I'm simply mimicking the construction of differential operators. That's all. So instead of ddx, ddx is also a translation, but on C, or on CL. On a g, instead of ddx, you naturally consider a tangent vector to the unit, and you think of it as a one-parameter family of maps of actions on the left, extended to the whole thing by right invariant vectors. Here is a teacher. So here is your g, that's the unit. Take a tangent vector. Think of it as a curve that is obtained by, you know, kind of e to the tau x applied to the unit. Tau is a parameter. That gives you a vector field by right translation, e tau x. So you use g to extend it to the whole thing. That gives you a map like this. That makes functions into g module, and you mimic it. You say that the zeroth operation is just this action, and the rest follows from the absence. How do you take care of that? Well, you simply have this. It doesn't spoil anything. It's very easy to see. So I could carefully explain this construction, but it really is, I think, I don't have much time, and this is trivial. I wanted to tell you an interesting thing, too. This part is tricky. The fact that no matter what the invariance or what the level is, this thing carries a vertex algebra structure in an obvious way. You just extend like this. It's a version of various extension results that Victor mentioned. Are you fine with this? Or do you want me to be more conscientious? For example, play with it. Imagine having, after all these are lectures, so here is an informal remark. How would you compute the operation between elements like this? Well, f is a function, g is a function. X and y are elements of either g or even the products of elements of g as they appear in this vertex algebra. Well, what can be more straightforward? You use the, as you see, you use the normal ordering product, normal ordering formula. You expand it, I mean this, of course. You expand this by the usual Borchardt's identity, and then these formulas unambiguously tell you how the x sub something feeds this thing. There is no, of course, x is commutes with g according to this formula and with y according to formulas there. There is no room for maneuver at all, and that's a guarantee that the vertex algebra x will be satisfied. Agreed? So here is a construction that avoids the discussion of that opaque thing, CH sub 2. You will always also notice that the reason both work, the proof that CH2 of t is 0 and the actual existence as manifested in this construction, both work for the same reason. That the tangent bundle is free. Here it's used in the fact that G freely generates all the derivations of the algebra, so there is no room for maneuver. That seems cold. There is no identities to that. And there it works for some reason that this course is not. So I don't have time. The scope of this course doesn't allow it. Right? Okay, so here is this family. So now we've got two families, the abstract one and a very concrete one. The natural question, is it the same? This, of course, is an exercise of the type, saying that they are the same, is an exercise of the type that this whole series of lectures essentially do. Or, namely, the computation of the product number 1. So, is the classification parameter space remember it was identified with the space of one force. And the explicitly exhibited family of vertex algebras, the same, R. And this at the same time. I don't think you'll be very surprised if I tell you that the answer is yes. And here is why. So let me relate one to another. So relating the former, no, the latter to the former. So what is it that I'm supposed to do? I need, so you see, at first point there is something to prove. Because the parameter C enters the two types of gain totally differently. Here it was due to the nature of that construction. That's how the fine vertex algebra is defined. In the classification result, that ended totally differently. Here, H3 of G. So how can one be related to another? Well, this has already been related to this space of parameters. It's a theorem. We just said that this can be identified with this, and this can be identified with C spanned by that form. Let me write it in form. Of course, I mean form such that its value in x, y, z is given by this formula. So there is this relation, but is it? Does it respect the gain here? It's just a separate result. Why is the corresponding vertex algebra obtained in the latter case coincide with the one obtained in the former case? How do we verify? Well, just as we did about half an hour ago, discussing the classification result. So, a three form arises like this. You have to take a basis let me call it tau of G and make sure that with respect to the one, the first product, the result is always zero. And then compute the zero product. And then compute to I zero tg. It should be one form. So, what will it be? That these are the rules of the game, you agree? That's how everything was built. Start with the basis. Operation number one can be taken care of. If you have a basis, make sure that on the basis vector is zero. But then, a room for maneuver appears in this. So what do we have in the former example by definition? Of course, instead of this, we have the famous formula like this. We have to make sure that this holds. The way of ensuring it has been pointed out several times. You can always, that's part of the classification. What you have to do is to subtract the value of a certain metric on this vector. In this case, the metric, of course, is this. So I replace tau r with that expression. And since I work geometrically, I will now think of all things involved here as being extended to the whole group by the right translation. So this is now an element of G star. And when I write it like this, I mean this same element extended over the entire G by right translation, such as these. I will identify, for example, G with its image in tau G right invariant, because that's the result of the action on the left. So, in the end of the day, what I have to do is take this and compute the zeroth product with this. You probably already see what's about to happen. So, I don't have much time, so I will have to resort to exercises. So these, remember, it was, by the way, this same type of computation that we did proving other previous results. I want to map one thing to another. It doesn't go so smoothly. At least I can manage to kill product number one. If I do that, stuff happens. In this particular case, the result will be this. So of course there will be the usual bracket. And now I want to think of this in this way. So minus this. The point of the exercise is that the result will be plus minus omega of or rather like this. Simple like this. You see that this is what we want. I make a transformation of the basic elements, but the result being that the classic formula, that the bracket is the bracket, has been changed. And it has been changed in exactly the way we wanted. But that's the value of that three form on two vectors. And that gives an identification of the former construction. Now, of the latter construction with the former.
I don't understand the difference between the second and the third.
There's no difference.
So they are the same.
With either plus or minus. I'm changing bases. And if it were just tau I, then the first product is, you know what, and the zeroth product is also you know what. I wanted to see that this is the same algebra that's produced by the classification. What does the classification say? It says all algebras are torsor over the space of closed three forms modulo exact three forms. Or, in other words, is a torsor all spanned by a specific split form. So I want to see that this simply encodes that form. How I do that? Well, how three forms and stuff arrives in the classification. You have to make sure that you fix operation number one. For example, in such a way that on the basis vectors it's zero. And then The rest of the operations are obtained by adding those three forms to the zeroth product. That's what I did. I changed my splitting. I got a different basis. It guarantees that the first product is fixed. In this way, I've got a non-trivial one form. And that exactly coincides with the one that's used in the classification. Hence, the former family has been identified, not quite uniquely, it depends on the choice of a basis, but has been identified with a lab classification. That's all. And again, if you think about it, it's the same type of computation that I started doing when I showed you the very beginning of the proof of that theorem. You have some standard formula, it doesn't work. It gives God knows what as far as the first product goes. If you want to kill it, then you earn a specific term, and that term was this classic either chalk silence or a T expression, something like that. Similar thing occurs here. So, we've got an explicit construction of the family of algebras of parallel differential operators, and that parameterizes the set of isomorphic classes of such algebras. This algebra is remarkable in many respects. It has been used, and one result in which it is remarkable is as follows. So I guess I will have only time to formulate it and perhaps add a couple of non-binding statements and then finish. So recall that we have the Lie algebra of all vector fields on G, and it has two embeddings. Let's think of it not so much a shift as the space of its global section. So this is a this is a CG algebra. And it contains two copies of G. One embedding is one I've used several times, generated by the left cell action on the left. The corresponding vector fields are then right and left. And this is given by the action on the right. Left is no better than the right, of course. Action on the left. And then the vector field elements here are extended to a left invariant vector field. You immediately see that, let me call it J sub L and this J sub R. By definition, these subalgebras of this bigger algebra commute. Then you can easily pass over to the associated algebra of differential operators. So the first embedding will be one embedding of the universal envelope, and the second, another. They will also commute in the same sense of the word. So the remarkable result is that all this correlates. So this is a remarkable result, but one that has a somewhat an unhappy history. Unhappy in that it was rediscovered unknowingly by several people. So we learned it from the private communication by Gates. That was later recorded in their important paper on parallel algebra of differential operators of the group. But I know from private correspondent that heavy differential and Boerfagen and also Boerfagen with search Homenka in a slightly different context all discovered this important fact in a variety of situations, close to this one, but perhaps different. So this much of this was done even before the notion of an algebra of parallel differential operators that was invented. So people work, for example, over an Excel object, things like that. But in any case, the theorem says that these two maps extend to two morphisms of universal vertex subspaces. One such morphism in my exposition was part of the structure, I mean this part. That's how I chose to define myself. Started with this. And a trivial result is, once you know this pair as I defined it, there arises a map of another universal finite algebra. And what really is remarkable is that it occurs at a dual level. So this is a really quantum chiral phenomenon. It occurs at the level, the dual level, which technically means the level equal to minus that minus Killing. So perhaps my last sentence. So the Killing fork is defined to be the trace of the product of operators adjoint X and adjoint Y. Of course, this all unfolds over the adjoint. Proof of this theorem is, again, at least in my language. I'm not sure about the Hippolyte's work. All the previous work was in this same spirit as I was trying to do, starting with something simple and then seeing what kind of corrections arise when you apply some obvious formula. Perhaps the Hippolyte have a real chiral algebra proof. I don't know, factorization spaces, I think like that. I think you don't know. As for this computation, it's very much in that spirit. Remember, this thing contained my fields Ti that I defined, so let me redefine them. So the actual Ti is this, not what it was previously. Now, classically, the right Ti right is given by some functions, AIS, tau S. Doing the vertex algebra version of this, of course, means that in this algebra I can take this. That's a classic expression, something that I have always started with. And if you play with this, with these fields, you will see that they fail. They don't quite commute with those, and their operations don't generate this algebra, and things like that. So, of course, as usually the case is you have to add one force. And those can be computed explicitly, absolutely explicitly. And then you verify. So just one of those numerous conditions gives you the correction, and then remarkably, the rest five or four such conditions, for some reason or other, are safe. I think I'll stop here, and I should tell you that I suspect it was much more pleasing to me for me to talk here than for you to listen to me. Thank you so much.